Welcome back to Retro Emulations, where the only pain involved is me, your host. This week, I'm going to be showing you everything you need to know to install DrUm78's custom version of FunKey OS for the FunKey S, Q36 Mini, and RG Nano, and give you a full setup guide to tell you everything you need to know to get your tiny gaming machine up online and ready to go. For the Nano, this is night and day, as this means finally getting rid of that annoying clock and unlocking access to over 15 new systems. Not to mention the ability to install third-party applications normally limited to FunKey OS, but more on that in a future video. All three systems, however, gain a massive benefit from this update. Now you can play all your games at a full 60 frames per second without getting any screen tearing, and you gain the ability to access the favorites menu, making navigation between games much easier and faster. Plus, it gets even better. You've got native support for Picoarch and ports within the Retro front-end launcher. Oh, and did I forget to mention that you can even use fast forward now? Sit back and relax, because as always, the only pain involved in this process is going to be me. First things first, you're going to want to head over to the GitHub at the address shown on the screen. I'll also provide links to everything mentioned in the description. You'll want to scroll down to the assets section and download the appropriate file for your device. FunKey S and Q36 Mini users have the option of upgrading the stock OS, but I only recommend going this route if you've already got a new SD card installed. If not, now's the time to do it. If you do want to upgrade your stock OS, then you're looking for the rootfs.fwu file, and installation is as simple as mounting your device to your PC and dragging the file to the drive it's been mounted at. Just unmount your device and the update should automatically install, and then you're done. Feel free to skip ahead to the time shown on your screen now. If you are flashing a new card, then you're going to need an SD card reader, as well as a new SD card, because the ones that come stock in these devices are usually pretty terrible. The new SD card has to be at least 16 GB, or it won't install correctly, and the maximum is 512 GB, but I wouldn't really recommend anything higher than 32 or 64 GB myself. Unless you're planning on turning this into a retro-themed MP3 player, there's not much of a point to go bigger than that. For this video, I'll be using a spare 16 GB card that I've had lying around for years, and even then I only ended up using about half the storage it had, so in this case, I'd say that less is more. Aside from an SD card and a reader, you're also going to need a computer with internet access and either a FunKey S, a Q36 Mini, or an RG Nano, plus a few other programs, which I'll go over next. Next, you'll want to head over to BalenaEtcher.io and download the appropriate version for your system. Once you've got that downloaded and installed, it's time to flash the image onto the SD card that you've prepared. Before we get started, you're going to want to back up the contents of the SD card already in your device. Personally, I just like to copy over the entire drive so that if anything ever does happen, I've still got the original files. If you don't like to do that, then you'll at least want to copy over the ROMs and BIOS files already present on your device. The BIOS files are located in either the Anbrnic or FunKey directory in the .libretro system folder, and the ROMs are sorted by system. For FunKey and Q36 Mini users, you'll want to grab any OPKs that you don't want to download again, which are typically stored in your applications, emulators, and native games folders. For RG Nano users, from my testing, it seems the Emulators OPKs don't work with FunKey, so you can just skip this step. Now, you just need to boot BalenaEtcher up and load the FunKey image file that you just downloaded, then select the microSD card as the target. Depending on the size of your card, this can take a decent amount of time. Once it's done, you can close out of BalenaEtcher, X out of any warning boxes that appear, and then eject your SD card. Now, you just need to insert the SD card back into your device, boot it up, and let the installer do its thing. When it finishes, you'll boot straight into Retro Front End using the Retro Rooms theme by default. You'll also notice two new collections to the left, Native Games and Lib Retro, which allow you to play those games from within the Retro front-end launcher. But more on that in a moment. For now, you'll want to power down your device and pop the SD card back into your computer. While the USB mounting feature is useful for small file transfers, if you're going to transfer large amounts of data at once, it's much faster to insert the card directly. If you didn't know, there's actually a wealth of third-party applications available for FunKey OS, and almost all of them work flawlessly on DrUm78's custom version. I'll go into more detail about everything you can add to your device, but for now, we're just focused on adding some emulators to finish getting your device ready. Head over to the link shown on screen and scroll down to SDL Retro. If you don't already have one, you should download a program like WinRAR 7-Zip or something else that will allow you to extract zipped archives. We're about to download a few zipped files, like the one we just did, and you'll need a way to access their contents. To start off, you're going to want to download the 1x1 OPK and then extract the cores from that folder to the Mount Libretro Cores directory. Your OPKs can go anywhere in the Mount directory, so I just recommend placing them wherever it makes sense to you. For now, leave that file manager window open and tab back over to the wiki. Next, you'll want to scroll down to the standalone emulators and download the SDL Retro Cores for all 5 systems that are available. Final Burn Arcade 2012, Final Burn Neo, Gambate, MAME 2000, and device. Extract them all to the Mount Libretro Cores folder you left open. Now, copy your cores folder and paste it to the Mount FunKey SDL Libretro directory, as this is needed for the SDL Retro OPK to function properly. As far as the standalone OPKs, you should at least get Fake08, Pokemini, and VB Emu. If you're feeling adventurous, you can look around and try some other stuff out yourself, but I'll cover the rest in a future video. For now, we're done grabbing everything you need, and you can copy all 3 of those OPKs over to the Mount Emulators directory. Now's the time to delete any unwanted freeware games that came pre-installed on your device, as well as move over your ROMs to their corresponding folders. If you backed up your files earlier, you should already have a nice set of ROMs lying around. I can't point you where to find ROMs directly, but I can say that you should Google Tiny Best Set Go. I can also recommend the terms Top 100 and Curated. Beyond that, follow any relevant laws regarding obtaining ROMs for the country you live in. Once you've got your ROMs, adding them is mostly as straightforward as dragging and dropping to the folders already present on your device. Do note that currently, probably don't have any art for any of your ROMs, but with a program like Skrape, and that's with a K, we can fix that. Let's download Skrape, and I recommend making an account if you don't already have one. Once you've got it installed and booted up, you should log in, and then you'll want to select the root drive of your SD card and select Scan Inside Archives. Make sure to navigate to the Media section. You should select it to save only one image, though, per ROM. Scraping takes forever, so you should do this while you move on to other things. This is also the perfect time to do it before you start adding other systems that don't have a way to display art. Make sure to select the ROM root folder as the output folder, and also you can resize the width to 240 and select Keep Image Ratio for a good compromise between aesthetics and saving storage space. Now, as far as what ROMs we can add, we have Atari Lynx, Game Boy, Game Boy Advance, Game Boy Color, Game Gear, Neo Geo Pocket and Color, NES, PC or TurboGrafx, PlayStation 1, Sega Genesis, Sega Master System, and WonderSwan Color. The 2 emulators doing double duty there are WonderSwan and Neo Geo Pocket, which both allow them to play the base games as well as the color variety. However, what you might not know is that the emulator used for Genesis can actually play Sega 32X and Mega CD ROMs, so you can include them in the Genesis folder as well. I just decided to include 32X or CD at the start of those games, so organization is a little bit easier. But you don't have to if you don't want to. For Pico8 ROMs, you'll want to make sure your folder is named Pico8 with no spaces at the Mount directory. I also recommend sorting ROMs into named folders by genre, since you'll only navigate through these games in GMenu2X. In the libretro directory, you should include folders for any and all of the additional systems you add, and then transfer your ROMs over to them. Of what is available, I personally recommend the Amstrad CPC, Atari 2600, Atari 7800, Atari ST, ColecoVision, Commodore 64, Magnavox Odyssey 2, MSX, SG-1000, Vectrex, Virtual Boy, and Watara Supervision. You should also place your arcade ROMs and Pokemon Mini ROMs in this folder as well. If you haven't already, you should also move the BIOS files you copied earlier back over to the new card in the Mount Funky SDL Retro System directory. Next, you need to make sure that there's a copy of the BIOS files for GBA, Sega Genesis, and PS1 in their respective BIOS folders. Then, you need to include the BIOS files for Sega CD in the Genesis folder if you want to launch those games in the Retro frontend. Lastly, you'll want to get a copy of your PS1 BIOS files and place them in the Mount Funky PCSX/BIOS folder. Now, your BIOS files for all the base systems should be taken care of. However, since we did pick up a few new emulators, there are a few additional BIOS files that we're going to need. Helpfully, the names of all these files are provided for you on the Funky Wiki, and it even includes where you need to place those BIOS files. For the vast majority, it's the same as all your other BIOS files, in the Mount Funky SDL Retro System directory. Once you've got your BIOS files sorted, you're all good. Got all that? Well, that's doubly good. It's time to eject the SD card and put it back into your device, then boot it up. Now that you're done, everything that already worked still should, except a little bit better. Your update comes with bug fixes, some improvements, and some very important features that we're about to go over. We're now running every system at 60 FPS instead of being capped at 50, and emulators now support searching inside subfolders for ROMs. It also added a few new applications and added support for showing extensions, particularly helpful for browsing ROMs with bin, queue, or other odd file types. If you want to know everything that's changed, be sure to check the GitHub page. We've got a lot to cover, so let's go over it section by section. Let's cover the new features available to us in Retro Frontend. If you're not in Retro Frontend already, switch over to it. Then bring up your menu and navigate to the Set Theme tab and change it to Pixel Plus. Feel free to change it back later, but for now, you can use it to help you memorize the keybinds for one of the primary new features, the ability to favorite games and easily navigate between them. When you have a game selected, you can hit the Y button to add it to your favorites. You can hit the X button to remove it from your favorites in either your collection or from your favorites. And if you delete the last game in your favorites, then the menu won't close until you back out of it manually. Once you have all your favorite games selected, all you need to do is press the Start button to show your favorites, and then hit the Start button again when you're ready to go back to your normal games list. Your list of favorites is stored on a per-system basis, so any of your favorite Game Boy games won't be showing up in the Game Boy Color or Game Boy Advance collections, and vice versa. Aside from favorites, the biggest change in this front end is access to both native games as well as Picoarch without the need to switch to Gmenu 2X. More importantly, though, is that almost all of these OPKs and emulators now get full benefit from the quick save feature, allowing for a whole new range of pick up and play options. Once you've finished messing around in Retro Frontend, it's time to switch back over to Gmenu 2X. Feel free to look through the new skins available and pick whatever appeals to you. You'll also find the OPK needed to set the clock on your device, as well as the other options you're familiar with. We do now have an unarchiver in applications, which does exactly what it says. Nothing exciting here, so let's move on. In the emulators tab, you'll also find your old emulators, as well as at least the three we added, plus any you've already got on your own. However, one of these emulators is not equal to the others. VB Emu and Pokemini are great, but their collective catalog of games number less than 100. Fake 08, on the other hand, allows you to play Pico 08, a theoretical virtual console that never actually existed, and there are thousands of amazing games out there for Pico 08. You can grab it for a one-time purchase of $15, and then you can install it on as many devices as you want to, forever. If you haven't tried out Pico 08 before, I can't recommend it enough. If you didn't know, Pico 8 carts are actually absolutely free, so there's nothing stopping me from sharing a link to Reddit where you can get a great collection of them. If nothing else, you should dust off your micro handheld and just fill it full of Pico 8 carts. I've actually been struggling to finish this video because I just couldn't stop trying new games. Seriously, I can't recommend it enough. But enough of that. Moving on to the last topic of discussion, and it's a bit of a doozy. In the Games tab, you'll find Picoarch and SDL Retro. If you're unfamiliar, they are libretro frontends that are built for tiny devices that function similarly to RetroArch. You use it to load a core, which you can then use to play a game. SDL Retro has very few, if any, options available to you that you can change, but it has a wider compatibility with games from my testing. Picoarch, on the other hand, has all of the options, but has no easy way to tell which core is used for what system. Luckily, SDL Retro tells you what core it uses to load a ROM, so you can just make note of which one it used, and then switch back to Picoarch. You also have to navigate to the location of your ROMs, but Picoarch remembers which location of the last ROM it loaded per core. So once you've made your selection, you won't have to make it again unless you're switching between ROMs for a given core, such as using Pico Drive for Genesis and Master System. In terms of which frontend to use, the answer is usually obvious. Picoarch, unless you can't get it working, and then try SDL Retro out. If you're still having issues, it may be worth trying out one of the standalone emulators, as some of them have better performance. Now, I haven't had a chance to test all of the options Picoarch has to offer, but I can help familiarize you with the options that are available. For example, let's boot up Gambate. When we hit the power button and scroll through the menu, you'll find a new option called Advanced. Select it, and a familiar menu should appear. This time, the menu for Picoarch, or more specifically, for the core that it's running. You've got your standard resume game, save state and load state, reset game, options, load new game, and exit. We're here for the options, so select that next. Under audio and video, you'll always find the same settings: FPS, CPU, screen size, filter, audio buffer, and adjustment. Player controls and emulator controls give you the ability to configure your keybinds for different functions, namely fast forward. Open emulator controls and bind toggle fast forward to L1 or R1. You can also go into emulator options, which varies wildly between systems, and play around with the settings in there. For Game Boy, you can set the colorization to whatever you prefer. Personally, I just went with auto and set ghosting to 50-50 for a compromise between performance and quality. And also, just like RetroArch, make sure to save your config after you've finished messing around with anything. Again, make sure to save your config after you've changed any options. Save it globally if you want to affect all ROMs for a given system, and save it on a per-game basis for everything else. Otherwise, any of the changes you make will not stay. One final note. All save data for Picoarch is stored in the Mount Funky Picoarch directory, so you can import your saves by moving them to that location. It's also possible to change the default emulators for Retro Frontend to use those of Picoarch, but that is far beyond the scope of this video, and is more advanced than anything we've covered so far. Let me know in the comments if that's something you'd like me to make a video on in the future. But for now, you're done. Well, now what, you may ask? Well, if you don't decide to try out Pico 8, then I'd say you should load up some of your favorite RPGs and give your tiny device another go. Maybe Pokemon, Final Fantasy, Fire Emblem, you name it. Or if you're into Pokemon ROM hacks or roguelikes, I can't recommend Emerald Rogue enough. You could get endless fun out of that one game. The world is your oyster, and you know better than I do what you want to do. So, what are you waiting for? Just go do it. I couldn't find anything online about how to get fast forward working for Funky OS, so I just sort of accidentally stumbled into figuring it out for myself. So I thought I would share. Be sure to like the video if you liked it, or dislike it if you didn't, and I'd appreciate it if you'd subscribe if you haven't already. It really helps me out. If you'd like to support me directly, you should consider becoming my patron on Patreon or heading over to my Ko-fi page. Thanks for watching, and until next time, I am the only pain in emulation. Thank you.